And share the screen. Graph plot. I didn't understand what exactly you want to know in graph plotting. Yeah, it's completely dependent upon you that which kind of graph you want. It can be scatter, it can be bar, it can be histogram, anything. Anything which you think will be the best suited graph to represent the values. It can be anything. Okay, so the questions are done. Now let's go for the class. So today, we are going to learn about decision trees. So decision tree is an algorithm which is mostly used for discrete target functions. Now, discrete target functions means it's not useful. It can, to be honest, it cannot be used in any target values function which are continuous in nature, like the target that we get from linear regressions, a ridge or lasso, you get a continuous one. But in decision trees, you cannot get a continuous one. So decision tree is only used for discrete values or a, what can you say? Again, I forgot the name. Categorical value data. So how decision tree works? Decision tree has a proper strict written algorithm which it follows for each and every data set. And on the basis of that, it classifies the whole of data that you provide him to make it as a tree. Now, how the tree is being formed is dependent upon two things. One, their entropy, and one, their gain information. Now we'll see what those two things are. Now, before that, let's see what exactly a decision tree looks like. Now I guess you remember the last example that I have given you, the play tennis thingy. So if you'll try to plot a graph of a decision tree of play tennis, you'll get this kind of graph. So with this graph, you can figure out that any case that you have given, what will be the answer. So if suddenly I'll be like, let's find a case, let's find a case, there's a case, okay, I can find a case here. So you can just imagine that there's a case, outlook is something, humidity is something, wind is something, overcast is something. So on the basis of that, what will be your output? So you can see that the outlook has three different outputs, sunny, overcast and rain. So every time the outlook is overcast, the answer of play tennis was yes. Every time the outlook was sunny, not dependent upon humidity. So every time outlook is sunny, if the humidity is high, the answer was no. If the humidity is normal, the answer is yes. So every time the outlook is rain, if the wind is strong, then the answer is no. If the wind is weak, the answer was yes. Now, this is a decision tree. How to represent it in a expression form? So, to represent a decision tree in a expression form, we just take the nodes which provides the value yes. So you can see there are three nodes which provide the value yes. This one, and this one. Now, what we do is we take the first yes value and like the first path of yes. Now the first path of yes is what? Outlook is sunny and humidity is normal. So the first path is outlook is sunny and humidity is normal. So this is the first yes path, union. Second yes path, outlook is overcast. So outlook is overcast. Now the third yes path, outlook is rain and wind is weak. So union. Outlook is rain and wind is weak. So we take all the yes path, combine it by the symbol union, and there you have it, the expression for a decision tree. So now you know that how a decision tree looks and how to represent it in a expression form. Now, the problems of decision trees. The instances are represented by attribute value pairs only. The instances that you're providing, even they cannot have any continuous data. they have to be in categorical data. Even the target value has to be the target data. Now, one of the two good things about decision trees are the training data may contain some errors, it's fine. Because when the training is happening, like when the testing is happening about the machine, it can handle the errors and it can also handle some of the missing values. So these are the two things which is really good for decision trees, that it's raw, that makes them robust, that it can handle the missing values data and it can handle the missing errors also. Now, two things that I told you in the starting, which is of the most importance of how to exactly construct this decision tree, is the entropy and the information gain. So first we'll go for what is entropy. First, let's see what is the formula of entropy. So entropy of S, of any, S stands for any of the feature, any other feature, humidity, wind, or outlook, any other feature. For that, the entropy is minus P of positive, log 2P positive, minus P negative, log P negative. So we'll see what exactly they are. Now, entropy is the measure of impurity in a collection. Impurity stands for how impure your data is or how imbalanced your data is. Now, imbalancement means if your data has 10 of, like if your data is telling that we have 3 yes answer, 3 no answer, it means the machine is balanced or the data is balanced because you have similar number of yes answers, similar number of no answers. But if your machine, if your data set has like 5, like 10 yes and only 1 no, it means your data is highly imbalanced. So entropy is a measure of the impurity or the imbalance. So if the entropy is less, like if the entropy is 0, it means your data is completely balanced. If the entropy is increasing, it means your measure, the data is more impure or it has more imbalancement. Now, we'll see what all P negative and P positive are. P positive is the proportion of the positive examples in yes, and P negative is the proportion of negative examples in yes. Negative example in yes, S. Now, what is negative and positive? We'll take one example. So imagine we have 14 examples of some Boolean concept, any 14 examples of the Boolean concept in which 9 are positive and 5 are negative. Just imagine we have a column in which 14 column, you have columns in which you have 14 rows. So it's written as either yes, yes, or either as no. Now in your data, you have 9 positive values. It means it has written 9 yes and 5 no. So how to find the entropy of that? To find the entropy of that, you have to find out the number of positive and negative. So we know that there are 9 positive and 5 negative. So there's 9 positive and 5 negative. So the entropy of this section will be minus 9 by 14. You can see this is a proportion of positive values. So out of the total values, which is 14, how many are positive? 9. So minus of 9 by 14, log 2 of 9 by 14, minus P negative, which is the proportion of negative examples. So out of the whole 14 examples, how many are negative? 5. So minus 5 by 14, log 2 of 5 by 14. So you get a number of 0.940. It means this is your numerical representation of how impure your data is. So every time you will see, if you have similar numbers for positive and negative, your entropy will get 0. So if you're like doing this decision tree on a paper and you found out, if you're trying to find an entropy and you find out that there are same numbers for positive and same numbers for negative, give it a 0. Now we have seen what is entropy. Now we'll go for information gain. Now information gain is the expected reduction in the entropy caused by the partitioning of examples in the attributes. Now what exactly it's telling that we are taking some of the attributes. What exactly we are doing in a decision tree? We are taking some of the features and splitting it. Like we took outlook and we split it in sunny, overcast and rain because they are the three characters. Now how we exactly decided that we took outlook on the first time only? Why we didn't take humidity in the first time? Or why we didn't take wind on the first time? And why after outlook and sunny, we kept humidity here? Why didn't we keep wind here? There are so many questions that we have to answer. So all the questions have been answered by information gain. So information gain tells us which exact attribute, which exact feature will help in the reduction of the entropy by partitioning with their examples. It's telling that which of the feature, like you'll find the information gain for each and every attribute, each and every feature, you'll find the information gain. And on the basis of that information gain, you'll get to know that on which particular feature will spit the data so that your entropy will decrease. And that's what we want to do. We want to decrease the entropy. We want to decrease the impurity in the model so that you'll have a proper decision tree. Because what decision tree is doing, just trying to remove the entropy from the model by splitting your data so that you can see now the humidity is high. You can see in this particular case, if the humidity is high, the answer will be no. Humidity is normal, the answer is this. It means it's pure data now. You have similar kind of data. If humidity is high, you have to get the answer as no. If the humidity is normal, you have to get the answer as yes. So this is how you distribute the data so that you'll get some fun result answer. So that's what you've tried to find out from information gain. Now, what is the formula of information gain? Now, the information gain formula of information gain formula is S of A is entropy of S, the same entropy. Now, S stands for S stands for the data that you are using. Like, as you can see, outlook is sunny, overcast, and rain now. So the data stands for this sunny, overcast, or rain. What exactly you're trying to split it onto? And S, where it is? Gain of S, S stands for the exact feature that you want to split it into. Now, gain of S of A, we have the entropy of S, which is the same formula. Just use the same formula, put it here. Minus summation of V till the values of A, it means the number of values of A till it comes. Mod of S of V, mod of sum of these values, where it went, sunny, overcast, and rain, divided by the mod of all the values, divided by mod of all the values, and the entropy of this particular value. Now it looks like kind of a messy formula, so we'll go through each and everything properly. Now, the first time, we'll try to find out the information gain for the value of wind. Now, if I'll show you the graph again, where is the data set? Where is the data set? Where is the data set? Okay, so you can see the graph here, the same graph that we have used previously. Now we are trying to find out the information gain for this particular feature. We have to find the outlook, like we have to find the information gain for all the features, all the features. Now we have to find the, for the first, we are trying to find the information gain for wind. How to find it? We're going to use the same particular formula. How to use it? We'll go through that. Now, before that, we have to find out how many different or unique attributes wind has. So wind has weak and strong. There are two different attributes wind has, weak and strong. Now we have to find S. S stands for wind of, S stands for the total of yes and no. The total of yes and no is this play tennis one. How many are yes and how many are no? Because it's not depending upon any of the things. You can see neither weak nor strong, nothing is there. So S will be common for each and every column because that's what we are gonna split it into. So play tennis and yes and no. So we know from the previous example also that there are 9 positive answers and 5 negative answers. If you've seen the data set also, you'll find 9 yes and 5 no. So we found out S and their weightage of how many negative and positive numbers are. Now we'll find out S of weak and S of strong. Now what is S of weak and S of strong? Now for wind, we'll go for what all values the value is. The water value, the value is weak. We'll go for weak, weak, weak. We'll take only consideration of those two rows, those rows for which the value of wind is weak. And on that particular situation, on that particular circumstance, we'll count how many are negative and how many are positive. So we can see it's representing that if S is weak, we have 6 positive values and 2 negative values. It means if the value of wind is weak, there are 6 positive and 2 negative values. So we represented as 6 positive and 2 negative. If you want to sure, make sure you can just try and check into the data set. It will be similar. Now, if wind is strong, we have 3 positive and 3 negative values. So if the wind is strong, we have 3 positive and 3 negative values. And I've told you, if you'll get any kind of this, like any this kind of function in which the number of positive and negative are similar, you'll get an entropy zero all the time. Sorry, entropy of one. Log zero is one. So you'll get entropy of one. It means it's completely balanced. Now we are gonna find the gain of S to wind, because this is the main function, like the outcome, which is play tennis. And now we're trying to find out the information gain for wind. We are gonna do it for each and every column. So for wind, what is the formula? Entropy of S. We have to find the entropy of S, which is this one, the output. So entropy of S, just put it here. The entropy of S will be the similar, 9 of minus 9 by 14 log 2, 9 by 14. So we'll get this particular number. So then this particular number has been kept here. Now we have to find out, the summation of SV of by S and the entropy of SV. Now SV by S stands for, out of all the attributes wind has, out of all the attributes that wind has, it will have 14 attributes. How many are weak? So out of all the 14 attributes, out of all the 14 rows, there are 8 weak and 6 strong. Now if you don't want to go and count it, you can just do the summation. Like if S is weak, how many are negative and how many are positive? So you can see for each and a, for 6 positive and 6 2 negative values, we have S weak. So in total, 8 for 8 values, we have S is equal to weak. So we put 8 by 14 here. Understood? This is the 8 by 14. Now, entropy of S weak. So take this distribution, which is 6 positive and 2 negative, and go and find out the entropy using this particular formula. So we'll get a number which will be 0.811. Now we'll go for S of strong. So out of all the 14 attributes, how many are negative and how many are positive? How many are strong? So we can see 3 are positive, 3 are negative. It means total 6 are strong. So minus 6 by 14 entropy of S of strong. So use this particular distribution to find out the entropy of that. So as I've told you, if they both are similar numbers, we'll get entropy of 1. So don't even try doing it. Just write 1 directly. So we have this particular formula, this particular expression. Evaluate it, you'll get a number which is 0.048. So this is the information gain related to wind. Now you have to do the same thing, exact same thing, for outlook, temperature, humidity and wind. Wind has been done. So outlook, temperature, humidity. So if you'll do this, as you can see, gain of S of wind is 0.048. If you'll do it for outlook, humidity and temperature, you'll get different values. And then go and find out which one has the highest information gain. And you can see gain of S of outlook gives us the highest information gain. It means that if you will split the data on the basis of outlook, you'll have the highest information gain. That's why what we took, the outlook function and we distributed for the very first time, we took outlook and we distributed. That's how we do the information gain. We use information gain to select which feature we have to choose to split it. Now information gain, now outlook has been selected for the first splitting. Now outlook has how many attributes? Sunny, overcast and rain. Now we'll divide the data set that we have, in this particular columns. Now you can see outlook is divided into sunny, overcast and rain. Now for outlook is sunny, we have D1, D2, D8, D9 and D11. It means for all the values for which outlook is sunny, we are taking that into consideration for this particular node. So outlook is sunny, we can see for where outlook is sunny. So D1, D2, D8, D9, D11. So these are the attributes for which outlook is sunny. Similarly for overcast, we have D3, D7, D12, D13. Similarly for rain, we have D4, D5, D6, D10, D14. Now, for every step, just check what is the distribution. Now for all, considering this distribution, like this set subset, which is D1, D2, D8, D9, and D11, we have 2 positive values and 3 negative values. For D3, D7, D2, and D13, we have 4 positive values and 0 negative values. For rain, we have D4, D5, D6, D10, and D12. For that, we have 3 negative and 3 positive values and 2 negative values. The moment we find condition like this, in which we have either only negative values or only positive values, we made it as a leaf node. That no need for any distribution there, because already the information gain has been maxed out, that you can get the answer from this particular node only, that we have only positive values. So just make it as a yes. Like you can see for this particular situation, there are four positive values. So we make this node as a yes node. Now we have to find out which attribute should be tested here and which attribute should be tested here, like which attribute should be put here and which attribute should be put here. Now the same thing that we did here in the previous time, we have 14 rows, we found out yes and no, then we found out the information gain for wind, humidity, temperature and outlook. We're going to do the exact same thing. The exact same thing we're going to do using only this data, like D1, D2, D8, D9, D11. How are we going to do it? Okay, so this is a rough idea, like how exactly we do it is for all this five, like 1, 2, 3, huh? For all this five data, we have 2 positive, 3 negative. So the answer output will be two positive and three negative. So this S will be 2 positive and 3 negative. Now we're gonna find out which, now for each and every place we have to find out which feature to be split on. Now outlook is already splitted, so we're gonna go for checking of temperature, humidity and wind. So we'll try for temperature. Like you can see, the output will try it for temperature, humidity and wind. So for the first number, we got the entropy as 0.970. As you can see, in the very first time, this one, the entropy of S is common for each and every attribute, 0.94. If you'll use for temperature, humidity and wind also, you'll get the same term, 0.94 only. So if the S is sunny for temperature, humidity and wind, we'll get the same answer with this entropy. We'll take this entropy and we're going to use it for each and every feature that we have, 0.970, 0.970, 0.970. And now depending upon what you are splitting it into. Now if you're splitting it into humidity, so we'll check humidity. Humidity is here. So how many different columns are there for humidity? High, normal. So there are two different categories of humidity, high and normal. So we have to find out how many are high, how many are normal, and on the basis of that, find out if they are weak. So if they are high, which are positive, which are negative. If they are normal, which are positive, which are negative. Then put the exact same formula of the entropies here, get the summation, and now you can see that there's minus in all the terms because the formula says minus of all the summations. So instead of you can do one more thing, like make a bracket, sum all the things, then put the minus sign, or just start subtracting from the starting only. Now you did the exact same thing. We got the values for, if the S is sunny, we got the values for information gain of humidity, wind and temperature. Which one is the maximum one? We found out humidity has the maximum value, which is humidity has the maximum information gain when outlook is sunny. So we're gonna put humidity here. Now this particular node has been already taken. It's yes. Now we're gonna check what should we put here. Now outlook is taken, humidity is taken. Now we're gonna check for only temperature and wind. So the next column, we'll check for temperature and wind. We'll check for humidity also. Why we check for humidity? There can be a chance that you'll get the more information gain of humidity here as compared to here. Probability, because you're checking it for the first time. You got humidity is 0.970 here. So we put it here and we don't try to find out the information gain of humidity here in this, in the second node. There can be a chance, like for this particular node, the information gain of humidity is 0.980. So it means humidity was supposed to be here. That's why, even though the model has been applied there, we don't leave the model. Before we exactly split the feature, we do not leave the feature behind in counting the information gain. So even for outlook of rain, we found out humidity, temperature and wind. So the same thing. The exact same formula, we get some answers and then we'll see which one is the maximum one. So if the humidity, so luckily in this case, the humidity information gain is 0.019, really less. For temperature, it's 0.019, really less. For wind, it's 0.970. It means it's highest one. So we're going to split it into wind and humidity. Now, if you'll try to split it into wind and humidity, you'll get the same condition as here, that if you're splitting it into wind of splitting it into humidity of high and normal, you'll get all if the values are normal, all the values are positive as yes, and if the humidity is no, all the values as no. If the wind is strong, in the wind condition, you'll get the same value as over this one, overcast and rain. That if the wind is strong, you're getting all the values as no, and if the wind is weak, you're getting all the values as yes. Now, if you, as I have told you, if you get any condition like this, that if you split your data and you get all the conditions, like I have shown you here, when the first time Outlook has been splitted, with Outlook. So with the first time when the Outlook is splitted, we have divided a data set here, like which are data set we are going to use, like which are roles we are going to use. So in this particular set, we have seen if all the things are positive, make it as a yes node, less leaf node. And if all the things are negative, make it as a no leaf node. So when we took humidity and we split the data, we found out that for if the humidity is high, all the attributes are giving the answer no. So we made as a no leaf node. If the answer is normal, so if the humidity is normal, all the data set are giving yes as the answer. If the wind is strong, all the data set are giving no as the answer. If the wind is weak, all the data set are giving yes as the answer. So this is what a decision tree is. It's a bit complicated. Like it looks a bit really complicated, and if you try to do it on paper also, it's gonna be complicated stuff to do it. But as I've told you, if you're trying to do it in Python, you do not have to take care of anything. All the things that I've told you right now, like finding the information gain, finding the entropy, everything will be done only by a single line, model.fit. You do not have to take care of anything. Now, we will go to the code. The decision tree code. So we use pandas here. We didn't use NumPy because we're not going to do any EDA stuff. The exploratory data analysis stuff is not here. And the data is completely like fine. So we use pandas as PD. Now we took a data set, salaries. Now, the salary has, this particular CSV has the company name, what job status they have, and what all degree the person has. And on the basis of all these three attributes, the machine is telling salary is more than 1000K or 100 or not. Zero stands for no, one stands for yes, they have. Now, as I've told you, decision tree will only work when your dependent variables will have the categorical data and the target variable will also have the categorical data. If any one of the column has a continuous data, the decision tree will not work. Just imagine like you're trying to split your data into a continuous of weight. You'll have 23, 24, 25, 26, you have different, like you'll try to split it onto age and you'll have like 10 to 15 different branches there. So only categorical data. Now we can see in this particular data set, we only have categorical data, that the company is only Google, ABC Pharma or Facebook. Nothing else than that. We took 15 data set, 15 rows only, comparatively really small data set. Now job as sales executive, business manager, computer programmer, that's it. So we have only three here. So degree, we have bachelor's or master's, only two. Now salary is more than 100K. Zero stands for not, one stands for yes. So only two. So this data set is the perfect fit for a decision tree. Now, there's one catch for decision tree. As I've explained you in this particular data set, in this particular example, that you're finding how many are Outlook, how many are in Outlook, how many are sunny, how many are overcast, and how many are rain. We can see like these two are similar because they are written as sunny. Decision tree cannot figure out that these two are similar because they have the same string as sunny. They're gonna find the numerical representation. If these two are zero, then they are similar. If these two are one, they are similar. The machine understands that. So before giving your model to the machine, we have to encode it into a format which is understood by the machine. So now if the machine wants to get to know the type of company by any number, like we can just specify that Facebook stands, like just take Facebook as zero. So all the columns in which Facebook is there, keep it as 0000. For ABC Pharma, we keep one. So all the all the places where ABC Farm is there, put it as 11111, and all the places where Google is there, we have to put 22222. So this is, that's what we have to do in your data set, and it will feel like a hefty task for you to find out how many different, like how many unique characters that you have, and then encode it. So for that, we have a library which is known as label encoder. That is the same thing that label encoder does, just take care of your encoding part. So it's going to go towards the column. It will find out how many different attributes you have, sorry, how many different values they have in the particular column, and then encode it into a number coded system, as you can see. So let's for this because when we have to apply the label encoder in this particular data set, what we did is we just split the data into inputs and targets standardly X and Y. Now input will have only this thing, only this one, company, job and degree. We have to drop the salary more than 10k. Now we're gonna use, we can use the same thing, which is df.iloc all the rows starting from the 0 till minus 1, but here we're just using one more different functions. Just to show you that to do a single thing, there's not an exact rule that you have to follow this thing only. You can do the same thing from different ways. So now what we are doing in this particular example, we are using the drop function. Drop function just takes the name of the column and then drop the column. That's it. And it asks you about the axis, like is it a column or a row? If you'll just give one and row, it'll just remove this one, this particular row. You provide here the name of the column and tell that the axis column, it'll remove the whole axis. So if remove the whole column only. So what we did, df the drop, salary more than 10k, it means go to this particular column and remove it. So input will have only this particular section, company, job and degree. Now what we want for the target, we want for the target only this particular section. So we took df of salary more than 10k. So we have input, if I can show you, input. Sorry. So we have only Google, we have only company, job and degree. Now what we have for target, we have target for the target, we'll have for the only the last column. And if we have only one column or only one row, we make it as a data frame. So the thing that we'll get is a data frame. Now we have the input and the output values. Now we have to encode it. Now for encoding, we use the function which is known as label encoder. There are different encoding techniques, label encoding, one hot encoding. For this we have to use label encoding, because what we want is for each and every unique value, assign it a number. And to do that, we use label encoder. So from sklearn.preprocessing library, we import the label encoder. We made an object for company, job and degree. So label encoder is equal, like label encoding of company will be label encoder. Like we just made three different attributes, three different functions. Now what we did, in this particular data set only, we made three different columns, input company of n, job of n, degree of n. It means company encoded, job encoded and degree encoded, which will be equal to this particular function LE of company dot fit transform. So if we want to encode the data, we have to use a function which is known as fit transform and provide the column for which you want to encode the data. So LE dot company fit transform input of company. So what we are doing, we want this particular column company of n should have the label encoded data of input of company. So we want to have this particular column to have the label. What happened by sniper transcode? Ignore. So we want this particular column company of n to have this particular data which have company's encoded value. So what we do, le of company dot fit transform input of company. So we can see the answer has been here, all the values have been encoded. ABC Farm has given 0, Facebook has given 1, Google has given 2. Okay, so job of n, for job of n we need to transform the value of the column of job into the encoded form. So the same thing, LU of job fit transform input of job, it's been encoded. Input of degree n, so we'll have this particular column which should have the encoded form of this column, which is degree. So le underscore degree dot fit transform input of degree. Take this column, encode it. So we have company, job and degree as the exact data that we had, and company name, job and degree name as the encoded data that we want for our model to be trained. Now we do not need company, job and degree, because the model will only be trained on company and job and degree and, because that's only thing that the model can understand. So we're going to just drop this particular three columns. So input n is equal to inputs dot drop company, job and degree, and x is equal to column. It means just drop these three columns. So now input n has only company and job and degree n. Now we have everything that we want, the data set, the target. Now what we do is same thing that we did from doing it from the like last week, train test split. So using train test split, we provided the data set, which is x, and the y as target. Training size, we are using 90 because there is only 15 attributes, so I'm not thinking of putting 70 or something. It will really reduce the accuracy because we don't have enough data. So training size is 90, which means 90% will have for training and the 10% will be there for testing. So train test split has been done. So from sklearn, you have to import tree. So in the previous one, like Ridge and Lasso, we have sklearn.linear functions. For decision tree, we have other folder which is known as tree. Now you do not have to remember everything, like in which particular exact folder decision tree is there, in which one random forest is there, in which one linear regression is there. You can just search it on the net and just write it. The more you'll use it, you'll more you'll remember which exact formula or which exact folder in which it's been kept. So no problem in that. So what we do is we just make a object of decision tree classifier. Make a model. So model equal to tree dot decision tree classifier. We could have written from sklearn dot tree import decision tree classifier, and then we have written model dot model equal to decision tree classifier. Same thing would have happened. We just import. We made it more messy. Fine. Now we have to do the same thing, x train and y train, and use the model.fit. There are many hyperparameters that you can choose on, class weight, criterion, max depth. And there's one function that is really good in decision tree of scikit-learners that you can classify, like as in the example that I've shown you, this one. We got our answer from the very like first node, like in the second level, you got our answer. There can be chance like the data set that you have provided is not even getting any answer. It's like trying to split, but you're not getting any answer. So on that you can provide the max depth. That till what depth the machine should try to build a decision tree. And if you get a whole decision tree before that max depth, it's fine. If you not get the any whole decision tree before the max depth, that's the max depth, it will go and it will stop there. Max features is how, what all features you're gonna consider. Max leaf node is like how many max leaf node you're expecting to have. Like out of all the values you have, I'm expecting to have at least three leaf nodes. So the moment you'll have three leaf nodes, the machine will stop. So you have on so many things that you can play upon. Now the model has been fitted. Now what are we gonna do? We'll try the model.score. Now it's one. Why it's one? Because we have only 15 data set. We use like 90% as our training data. So for testing, we have like what, one or two. Let's see how many we have for testing. X test. We have only two. So the machine guessed both of the answers completely right. So this is decision tree. We'll go through like the advantages and the disadvantages. So the advantages, it's really good for data which have missing values, so it can handle the missing values really easily. It can handle the errors also really easily. There's one big disadvantage of decision trees. It's really, really prone to overfitting, because if your data has more attributes, like just imagine we have the data set, this particular data set, outlook is only overcast or only sunny, or they're like in like 13 rows you have outlook is sunny and only one you have rain. So the model can really overfit. So this is one of the problem of decision tree classifier, that it's really highly prone to overfitting. To handle that overfitting problem, we've made one more model, which is known as random forest, which we'll learn tomorrow. So yes, this is decision tree. If you have any questions, you can just put it into the chat. I'm expecting someone to have any question. Yep. Let's see. What is model overfit? Did you attend the first class of machine learning, bro? And you didn't took the responsibility or took the effort of watching the recorded session or the session like or the video that I sent you. I've sent some videos in the group for the first session that I haven't recorded. Okay, no problem. How to work on the problem of overfitting the case of logistic regression? The only problem of logistic regression is this overfitting. So if you want to like really tackle the problem of overfitting, just have to play with the hyperparameters. And the only problem with why overfitting exactly happens is because of the data set. Like, this is the main reason of overfitting, that your data set is completely tilting towards one of the attributes or one of the features so much that your model is training up way too much to that particular feature. So if you want to have a completely fine model, make sure that the data set only doesn't favor any one feature, expect any compared to any other one. But if you have the overfitting problem, two things that you can do: either try to play with the hyperparameter so that the overfitting has been reduced. If not, there's something called data augmentation. I guess that's data augmentation. Yeah, it's a term which is used for deep learning. So what we do in data augmentation is we take the same data and we try to replicate the data again and again to make it imbalanced. Like as I've told you, we have data we have 15 rows in which 10 are male, 5 are female. Now it's completely imbalanced. Now what we do is we take that five female data and just copy paste it. We have the same thing. So now, even though we have the same data that we're providing for the five rows, we have the equal status. So each and every value will have the equal weightage. This is one other thing that you can do in overfitting problems, but it's not a really good solution. Like, there are stuff in which you can do in logistic regression, and overfitting is a big problem. So you have to come up with different techniques to find out the overfitting problem. I didn't record the, I didn't record the particular session, but I sent some videos to watch. Okay, no problem. So overfitting is when you give some kind of a data to a model, but what happens is the model is trained on that particular training data that way too much. And way too much means if you're giving any data set which is exactly into the training data, it will give you the accuracy of 100%. For each and every value, it will guess the exact answer. But if you'll go any number, like any data set which is outside the training data, that the model has not been trained on that particular data set, then you're gonna give a really random result. So if I'll try to represent you with a graph, I guess I have a picture of overfitting. Let's see if I do have. Okay, so Yeah, I do have. Let it open. So here, this is the condition of overfitting. So that the data that you have provided, the machine is trying to go through each and every data point that you provide. It means it's not trying to be generalized. It's trying to be completely overfitting towards the training data. So that if you'll give any data point which is completely, which is in the training data, which means just imagine you're providing this training data. This data as a test to test, you will get 100% accuracy. But if you will provide any other data point, which is like outside the training data, like a point here or a point here or a point here, then it cannot guess the model, like it cannot guess the answers properly because it's not generalized. As you can see in this particular, which it's infinity because this is a general line, which can extend it to anywhere, but this is not a general line. It's completely random and it's completely trying to overfit towards the data that you provided. So you cannot extend it anywhere. This is like completely closing the training data only. So this is what overfitting is. So decision tree is highly prone to this overfitting condition. Can't we use another method to parsing? Yes, you can. You can use logistic regression. So what we exactly get in logistic regression is the classification of yes and no. We can use decision trees also. If the data that you have is also categorical, you can use decision trees. And we can also use support vector matrices. It completely depends on what kind of data that you have and which is suitable. Okay, any other questions by any other people? How many are there right now, by the way? Six. Okay, looks like everyone is fine now. If no one has any question, just give a thumbs up so that I'll get to know that everyone is fine with this topic. Vignesh is fine with the topic. Hitesh is typing. This time I'm expecting something to come from Hitesh. Welcome, Hitesh. Shashank is fine. So, looks like everyone is fine today. So, this concludes today's session. Tomorrow, we'll go through random forest. So, just in short, I'll tell you. Random forest is, as the name suggests, it's a forest. And what forest has? Trees. So, random forest is just a collection of different decision trees. To find the similar answer, we're just having 10 or 15 different trees. So we'll take care of what exactly random forest is in the next class. Till then, bye-bye. Happy learning.